Welcome everyone, I'm Rupali, a counselor and a hypnotherapist, and today we have with us Mr. Nitin Shah, who is the CEO of IHAS, which is an Institute of Clinical Hypnosis and Related Sciences, and today's topic is NLP, which is a neuro-linguistic programming. And without any wait, we'll start with the discussion. So, Nitin sir, what exactly this NLP is?
Okay, so NLP stands for neuro-linguistic programming. There is really no specific definition for it. Some people call it the manual of mind, some people call it practical psychology, some people call it study of excellence. But if there is one definition that probably suits NLP most, it is that it is a model of human behavior. It is a model that helps us understand why we do what we do and how exactly do we do it. Most importantly, it gives us a sequence of techniques which we can use to create a change even in those behaviors that we have not been able to change, provided we want to change them. So that's what NLP really is. But if I were to go into a bit of a technical definition, then obviously NLP stands for neuro-linguistic programming. So neuro represents how our brain works. Linguistic represents language, how we communicate with others as well as with ourselves. And programming represents how language and the working of mind are connected to each other. So for example, let's say when I think of God, right? I have the image of God in my mind. Yeah. That becomes the language. That's the way I'm talking to myself. Yeah. The moment I see that language, that is that image of God, I feel calm. So my body is naturally releasing the chemicals that makes me feel calm. My brain is doing that automatically, which means there is an automatic connection between that language of the image of God and the feeling of calmness. This is like a program that every time I think of God, I more or less naturally start thinking about or feeling calm. And this can be true for everything. You know that there are places where you have certain people, you look at their face and you just feel angry. Like you just don't even have to think about anything. You look at their face and you get angry.
So it just like happens with everybody.
It happens with everybody. It's a very automatic program that kind of is running for us, right? So NLP ends up helps us understand how these programs are created and how you can change these programs.
Change means like completely restructure it, or from the beginning you take out the roots and changed it?
See, it depends. So when I say change, it depends on what you're looking for. So for example, today I look at my boss and I feel very angry. I would rather just want to feel calm so that I can improve my situation with him going forward. Then NLP can help you do that. It can just rewire the system in a way in which the next time when you look at your boss, you feel calm rather than feeling angry.
That's excellent.
Brilliant. And at the same time, there are places where some emotions are more deep-rooted.
Yeah.
Right? So it's not just that I'm feeling angry because of something that boss was doing in the past. But it could also be that that boss reminds me of my father, that father reminds me of my grandfather, and there's like a sequence of history because of which I experience what I experienced today. In which case, I may also need to work with certain things related to past. And NLP would also help you understand that it has techniques to be able to help you address that. Though those techniques are not very popularly practiced by most people, simply because many practitioners of NLP themselves don't have the grasp that they need to be able to use those techniques effectively. But as a field, NLP contains some of those techniques that you can use with people, even to change deep-rooted issues that are coming from the past. Okay? And also you could just reprogram the mind from present and future point of view.
That's brilliant. So, who created this NLP?
Right? So, NLP was created by predominantly Bandler and Grandler, who came together to study people. When they studied people, they observed what is it that they were doing which was working. And predominantly, they began by studying three people. There was Virginia Satir, yes. Fritz Perls, and Milton Erickson. Now, all three of them were brilliant therapists in their own rights.
Yeah.
Virginia came from family therapy, Fritz Perls created Gestalt therapy, and Milton Erickson is considered to be the best if not his ever. Because they were so good at what they did, Bandler and Grinder wanted to study them and understand how is it that they are able to get results. But other people who are following a similar modality of treatment are not able to get the same quality of results as these people are getting. Which means obviously they were doing something different. It was not just about the modality, it was about something that they were doing. So they wanted to study that. When they spoke to each of them, each of them said we do what we do because we intuitively know what needs to be done. Mm-hmm. Right? We just know it. We know what questions to ask or what statements to speak or what processes to use. Now that's very, it's random, right? Random in the sense that if I want to teach someone to do therapy, how do I teach someone to know exactly what question to ask where? You can't really teach intuition, so as to say, right? Mm-hmm. So Bandler and Grinder wanted to study these people and see if there is some structure to this intuition. Can they find a process that was an unconscious process that these people were following, which could then be converted into a structure and taught to other people? And that's how they came up with NLP. They studied these three people. They realized that while they thought they were using intuition, there was a pattern to their intuition. There were specific places where, or indicators where, Virginia would ask certain questions, or Fritz would use certain statements, or Bandler or Erickson would use certain suggestions. So they studied that. Out of that, they created structures and models.
About how to ask questions?
Both. How to ask questions, how to give suggestions, how to create change in people. And that's how NLP originally got created. And that's what is called the modeling process in NLP. So if there is one predominant thing that people need to understand about NLP is that NLP is based on modeling successful people. If one person can do one thing and they've been able to do it successfully, you can understand the process that they followed, and if you replicate the process in exactly the same way, you will get the same result.
So it's like a pre-assumptions which you believe in NLP?
So this is the pre-assumption that if one person can do something, everyone else can do it. You just need to know what is the process that the first person followed.
Oh.
If you follow the same process, you will get the same results. Right? Which is actually not really an assumption, that's kind of common sense.
Yeah.
Right? But if a set of steps have created an outcome, then every time you follow the same set of steps in exactly the same way under the same circumstances, obviously it will give you the same results. You just need to be able to understand those set of steps and the circumstances in which those steps have to be applied. So initially they began by observing these therapists, and then they expanded their work. They also wanted to study other people who are achieving success in other areas of life. Right? And from there they created different models, different techniques, both that could be used in therapy and that can be used in self-help or for self-help purposes. And that's how NLP expanded, and today it is what it is.
Excellent. So next question is, that is why modeling is considered as like very important aspect of NLP?
Yeah, so everything in NLP is based on modeling.
Okay.
Eventually then obviously it's based on modeling certain set of people, but the whole concept is you can model a person, and if you can model them effectively, you will be able to get more or less the same result that the person that you're modeling, you're getting.
Excellent. So, Ms. Lee, what are the primary principles of NLP?
So, the primary principle is this, that you need to be able to model people correctly. But the thing that you need to be aware of is that modeling is not just about modeling people's behavior.
Mm-hmm.
It's also about modeling people's thoughts. It's also about modeling people's emotions. It's also being able to understand the context in which they are thinking, feeling and behaving the way they are behaving. The reason why modeling for a lot of people may not work is because they only try to mimic behaviors, and they think mimicking behavior is modeling, which it is not. Modeling is a more comprehensive process. It's about understanding that if one person is behaving in a particular way, what is the emotion that's driving their behavior? What is the thoughts that's driving their emotions? So to that extent, modeling is a lot more comprehensive. Okay, it's effective if you do it correctly. But if you only think of modeling from a point of view of replicating a person's behavior, mimicking a person's behavior, then well, you will get as good a result as a mimic would, but you may not be able to get as good a result as the original person would.
Nice. So, how is NLP different from other therapies like RECBT?
So, see, when you're using NLP for therapy, eventually you're working with the same mind, right? So, all the basic assumptions, no matter which therapy you use, will remain the same. The preconceived notion is this, that your behaviors are driven by your emotions, are driven by your thoughts. All of these influence each other. Your thoughts and your emotions may be driven by certain beliefs, certain filters that you have, which are a result of the way you have been brought up. So, to that extent, all fields of therapy more or less are similar, be it RECBT, be it NLP, be it any other field that you want to pick up. Where there is a difference is in the specific techniques. So RECBT or REBT or CBT or Gestalt would have its own set of techniques. right? NLP has its own set of techniques. The primary principles will more or less remain the same. The presentations will change, but obviously you're working with the same mind, the same human behavior. So the core principles can't change from therapy to therapy. What changes is the application of those core principles. Okay? Especially between therapies, which are all talking about amalgamating, working with thoughts, emotions and behavior all together. Obviously, there are other fields of therapy which only talk about working with behaviors directly. Then there would be some differences. But between RECBT and NLP, it's more a difference of the techniques that you are using. And also, as I said, with NLP, you would be also able to work with past related issues if there are any, right? Generally, RECBT, CBT, RECBT will not really focus so much on working with past. The idea is more about working with thoughts and emotions in the present, beliefs in the present, and then creating a change from there. Yeah. NLP, to that extent, may have additional set of processes to work with your past deep-rooted experiences also.
So mostly we listen that NLP is combined with hypnosis. So how is hypnosis and NLP or is difference or similar to
one another? Okay. Yeah. So as I said, a major part of NLP is based on Milton Erickson's work.
Yeah.
Milton Erickson is considered to be the best hypnotist ever. Yeah. In our assessment, every change process in NLP is based on hypnosis. There is no NLP change process that does not use hypnosis. They may not induce hypnosis separately. That's a separate issue, which means some of the NLP techniques are designed in a way in which the technique itself induces the hypnotic state and then you can start working with the person. So it's more like short-term or applied hypnosis. In fact, in one of the recent videos that I had seen of Bandler, someone had asked him, how would you define hypnosis? And one of the ways he defined NLP was that NLP is applied hypnosis, which is actually a very apt definition. Where NLP is different from hypnosis is that in classical hypnosis program, there is no focus or emphasis on interview. Okay? It's assumed that if you are learning hypnosis, then you already know how to take cognitive interview, how to sit with people, how to understand their problems and work with their problems. NLP also has structured models which will help you understand what questions to ask people where at a conscious level so that you can help them understand their problems better. So that's the place where NLP would, in terms of techniques, be different from hypnosis. But change processes eventually all boil down to hypnosis.
Okay, so NLP and hypnosis both hand in hand?
They go hand in hand. So, okay, the way I would explain it is, and that's the way we also explain it to people who want to learn hypnosis and NLP. Think of NLP as a brilliant, really fast car that helps you travel to places. As long as you know how to drive the car, and the car is working, the car can take you to places till the car breaks down. Now when the car breaks down, unless you know the nuts and bolts of the car, how was the car created, then you can't really do much with that broken car. And that's where hypnosis comes in. So hypnosis gives you that understanding of the nuts and bolts behind NLP, and NLP is the application of that hypnosis into more practical, more short, more quick but effective techniques. In our assessment, if you really want to benefit from hypnosis and NLP, you should be learning them as a comprehensive package. Okay? And a comprehensive package where both of them are given due credit. When I say this, I'm saying this because nowadays we are looking at a lot of institutes that are claiming that we are teaching NLP and hypnosis both. But when you actually go through their curriculum, you realize that they only teach you hypnosis inductions and they think hypnosis is hypnosis inductions. And then they cover NLP program. Or there are hypnosis institutes that cover everything about hypnosis, but they have like 2-hour, 3-hour model of NLP and they say we have covered NLP and hypnosis together. That's not true. Hypnosis is a lot more than induction. Hypnosis is understanding the nuts and bolts of how everything works. Not just from a application point of view, but also from a theoretical, from a conceptual point of view. So that if your particular technique that you have is not working, how do you tweak that technique to make it work? On the other hand, NLP is the actual expertise of being able to convert those hypnotic principles into practical activities. Which means no matter what theoretical concept you come across in your life, whether it is from hypnosis, whether it is from NLP, whether it is from any other field.
Yeah.
If you know hypnosis and NLP together, and if you like the theoretical concept, you will probably be able to create a practical activity out of it to create a change. But that you can only do if you have a proper understanding of both hypnosis and NLP. One without the other is kind of incomplete.
You may get results from it, but it may still not be like the package that you would want to have. Also, before you ask me the next question, see, when people learn hypnosis, NLP, CBT, RECBT, a lot of them actually feel that they get confused. I don't know with people which technique to use where.
Yeah.
Right? The advantage of learning hypnosis and NLP together, and probably also learning it in a way in which you can combine it with a couple of other fields, is that you actually understand the combination and the integration. Which means that in future, any other process that you learn, or in the past, any other process that you have learned, you would be able to combine it with hypnosis and NLP, rather than thinking of it as either or. So you can really use an eclectic approach towards creating change if the two of them have been learned comprehensively together.
Okay, so to build on that question, how much time does it take to be an NLP practitioner? Like, how long does the course is?
So truly speaking, NLP, hypnosis, all of these fields talk about human behavior, human mind. This is an incredibly vast field.
Yeah.
So really, there is no amount of time that I can give you that I'll tell you will make you a master of everything in NLP and hypnosis.
Okay.
With more and more practice, with more and more work, you actually realize that there are new and new things that you're becoming aware of that you were not aware of earlier.
Yeah.
Having said that, a good NLP program, so generally an NLP program is divided into practitioner and master practitioner. So a good NLP practitioner program would be minimum 7 days. A good NLP master practitioner program would be minimum around 10 days. This is if you're only doing NLP.
Okay.
If you club them with hypnosis, and depending upon how it is being clubbed, if it's only online, if it's classroom plus online, or if it's only classroom, then obviously the duration may vary a bit.
Okay.
We have a program, for example, our current practitioner program, which includes hypnosis, NLP, and mindfulness into a single curriculum, along with coaching competencies, takes you around 12 days. 5 days for the introductory program and 7 days for the advanced program. That's our practitioner program.
Okay.
And then the master practitioner program is again another 15 days after that.
Excellent.
And even after that, there's a lot of post-workshop support that we provide, because we realize that while you're learning a lot of things in the program, your actual skill building will happen when you practice with people outside the workshop. So there's a lot of ongoing support that's provided. We have people who stay in touch with us even after a year, because at times they get a client and they realize, oh, this is
something new that has come up.
Correct.
Yeah.
And then they need slight help and so on. But over a period of time, you realize that their expertise, their mastery is far greater. Over a period of time, rather than they connecting with us to ask us what needs to be done, they connect with us to tell us, this is the new case that we handled. This is what we have done. We think we have got the result, but we are just cross-checking if we could have done something different. So, to that extent, it can be a very comprehensive work, but also it depends on why you want to learn NLP.
Oh, okay.
If you are a trainer or a coach and you are not going to apply NLP towards therapy, which means intense negative emotions or disorders,
yeah,
then probably only the practitioner program is enough.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm saying practitioner program in the way we do it, because we have also slightly tweaked the program so that all coaching related aspects is covered during the level 1 and 2. And all therapy related aspects is covered during the level 3 and 4, which then becomes the therapy or therapeutic skills program based on NLP, right? So if you are a trainer or a coach, probably the practitioner program is enough for you. If you are also a therapist, and I highly recommend that you also do the master practitioner, because there are techniques that will then help you work on intense negative emotions, disorders, issues related to past, which a lot of therapists do focus on.
Seems like you provide a really wonderful service, sir. But as you have mentioned about coaching, like, how does this coaching and NLP differ? Is the one I'm seeing?
Okay. So NLP is a philosophy and a series of techniques.
Okay.
Right? When you apply it towards coaching purposes, you make your coaching process more effective.
Hmm.
When you apply it towards therapy purposes, you make your therapy process more effective. So NLP is neither coaching nor therapy. NLP is a set of techniques and philosophy which can be applied for both. Now, the key distinction that you need to understand is, what is the difference between coaching and therapy?
Yeah.
Right? So coaching is about working with present and future.
Mm-hmm.
You would not work with intense negative emotions, you would not work with disorders, you would not work with things related to past.
Yeah.
Therapy, on the other hand, also helps you develop skills to work with all of these things. So if you are learning NLP and you want to only work with people with respect to their present and future, NLP can be a very effective tool complementing your coaching practice. if you are also a therapist who is working with intense negative emotions and disorders, NLP can also help you, assist you in making your therapies more effective. Okay, so it can be applied towards both. I wouldn't say there is a difference or similarity, because as I said, it can be applied towards both. It just depends upon who is applying it and what is the credentials with which they are applying.
Oh, so is the NLP practitioner is a coach or a therapist?
NLP practitioner is neither a coach nor a therapist. NLP practitioner can also have coaching competencies and use NLP techniques as a part of coaching. An NLP practitioner may also be a trained psychologist or a psychotherapist and may want to incorporate NLP techniques into their practice. Okay? So NLP by itself, okay? A lot of NLP coaching programs are there, but that's because there is no coaching regulation. Right? So to that extent, a lot of NLP programs have added coaching competencies and they would call themselves an NLP coaching certification program. So that's completely fine because of lack of any regulations for the same. But as far as therapy is concerned, even if you are a trained NLP practitioner, a master practitioner, unless you have a master's in psychology or you are trained in psychology related concepts, you should ideally legally not be practicing NLP therapy. Because you are not a psychologist, you are not supposed to work with intense negative emotions or disorders. And if you are interested in doing it, please do a master's program in psychology.
That's wonderful. But apart from this NLP technique used in psychology field, is there any other areas in life that we can apply this NLP?
See, as I mentioned, NLP is about understanding how the human behavior works.
Yeah.
So any area where you are going to interact with people, whether others or yourself, NLP will be extremely useful. So you can use NLP for building rapport, you can use NLP for persuasive communication, you can use NLP for managing your emotions, your thoughts, you can use NLP for helping other people manage their emotions, their thoughts. All of these can be applied towards sales, towards HR, towards leadership, towards coaching, towards therapy. It can be applied towards marketing, towards advertising. A lot of good speakers use NLP linguistic patterns or hypnotic linguistic patterns as a part of their speeches to be able to have highly influential speeches, right? So any area of life where you are going to interact with yourself or others, which basically means every area,
yeah.
You can use NLP in some format or the other.
Excellent. So our next question is, can NLP used for spiritual growth?
Well, again, as I said, any area where you are going to interact with any set of people, including yourself, it can be used. Right? When we say spiritual growth, actually I have a completely different view and opinion on spiritual growth, but that's probably a different video for a different time. But even if I were to go with the standard definition, the standard understanding of spiritual growth, right? When you mean spiritual growth, what do you mean? People generally mean that we want to evolve into becoming better, which means we want to create a change in ourselves. The moment you're talking about creating a change in yourself, you're actually saying that there's an existing program that's running in my mind, which I feel is not in sync with my spiritual growth. I want to be able to change that program. I want to develop more awareness. I want to develop more emotional control. I want to develop more empathy, right? So all of this is about creating a change in yourself. Any place where you're going to create a change in yourself would require you to interact with yourself.
Excellent. So our next question is that, is NLP scientific? Or so, many people also think that it's a pseudoscience.
Okay, so that's actually a good question, because truly speaking, NLP is not one thing. NLP is a combination of a lot of things. Right? NLP includes multiple techniques. NLP has techniques to be able to help you manage your emotions. Mm-hmm. NLP has techniques to help you manage your thoughts. NLP has techniques to help you observe people, understand people better. NLP has techniques to be able to help you work with your past. NLP has techniques to be able to help you define your future.
Yeah.
Okay. NLP also has certain experimental techniques which are about being able to assess people based on what you're observing them. Okay. So because NLP is not one thing, NLP has multiple techniques, and for each of these things that I've told you, for example, managing emotions, there are multiple techniques in NLP to manage emotions. Some of these techniques are well established, which means that they are scientific to an extent that every time you use them, you more or less get the same set of results, right? But some techniques are experimental, and some techniques are simply mumbo jumbo. See, because Alright, so you have to understand, NLP as a field is based on observing people, right? When you're observing people and you're creating techniques, you're experimenting with some techniques. That's how any field evolves. It's even like medicines, right? So when you are, when a new medicine comes into the market, some medicines are tested upon and they give you results, and they are then released and you can use them, doctors prescribe them, and some medicines are experimented and they don't give results, right? Only because some medicines were experimented and they did not give results. Would you say that the entire medical field is unscientific?
No.
Because there are different medicines which have also been effective, which are also giving results. So if you were to try to assess whether medicine is scientific or not by using one medical or one medicine as a reference point, I think that's doing injustice to the entire field. It's the same problem with NLP. So the thing is, in classical psychology, if you actually think of it, any field which is considered scientific or evidence-based is scientific or evidence-based because they have one set of primary technique which they use to create change. That's both the limitation and the strength of the technique. Strength because then you can test that one set of technique everywhere, right? Limitation because those one set of technique or two set of techniques will not be applicable everywhere. So most so-called scientific techniques will tell you that this technique is useful over here and cannot be applied to these set of people. With NLP, that's not the case. Depending upon the people, you can tweak your techniques, you can change your techniques, you can completely have different set of techniques. So there is no one technique based on which you can define whether NLP is scientific or non-scientific. There are techniques in NLP which are highly effective, okay? Because eventually NLP is based on, or at least a lot of NLP techniques is based on studying psychologists who are effective. So if we are saying that those techniques are not effective, we are actually saying that those psychologists who are effective are not effective. There is kind of a contradiction over there, right? At the same time, I agree that there are a lot of things which are being sold in the market in the name of NLP, which are either outdated, which even the founders of NLP have discredited, okay? Or there are things which are experimental, which are being sold in the name of NLP, but they are just in experimental phase. They are not really part of core NLP teachings, right? And but it's a unique selling point, right? So, for example, one of the things about NLP which is unscientific, a lot of people say NLP can be used as a lie detection tool. Okay? That's rubbish. Okay, yes, there's some application of NLP in terms of being able to assess whether people are recalling information or constructing information. But that's very subjective.
Yeah.
One, and that can change from people to people. But because it's a selling point, a lot of NLP institutes sell their NLP programs saying NLP can help you detect a lie.
That's bizarre, actually.
That is bizarre. That is bizarre to an extent, right? But the problem is now it's a unique selling point for a lot of NLP institutes, so they want to use it to sell their program. But it also becomes one of the biggest reasons why people think NLP is pseudoscience. So you have to be careful about the institutes that you are learning from, because a lot of those institutes are talking about experimental things, which may not be time tested, which may not be something that you can reliably depend on. Okay? And that's actually one of the reasons why I said you should learn hypnosis, because that's the way you will be able to understand why these experimental processes are experimental, and if they are not working, how to tweak them, how to change them, how to work on them. Okay?
So, as you have mentioned the scientific place, are there any research paper that someone can go through?
So, there are a lot of research paper on specific techniques in NLP. So what I'm going to do is, I'm not going to really quote any of those researches right now, but in the comments section, I would add a couple of links that you could check out later on to be able to notice what those research papers are or what those researches are, right? So it kind of makes it easier for you to do a bit more background check and so on. But if you ask me, is there a research paper on NLP as a whole? I don't think there can be one, and if there is one, that would not be reliable, because different techniques in NLP are completely based on different baseline understanding.
Okay.
There's a lot that changes from people to people, from problem to problem. So therefore, there would not be one technique or one research on NLP as a whole. But if you pick up specific NLP techniques, for example, if you pick up anchoring is classical conditioning, right? Now, if you say anchoring doesn't work, you're basically saying that behavioral psychology, classical conditioning doesn't work. if you're willing to say that, then well, go ahead and say that. But that will be difficult for a lot of people to digest, right? Similarly, when we talk about certain thought management techniques in NLP, then you can change your thoughts with these techniques, which will help you change your emotions, which will help you change your behavior. Okay, that's what CBT is based on. If you're saying that technique in NLP doesn't work, then you're basically saying CBT doesn't work.
So NLP has taken from everything.
I wouldn't say NLP has taken from everything. NLP has techniques which are based on multiple philosophies depending upon what you're working with. Okay? And therefore it's kind of impossible to have one research that says NLP is completely scientific or completely unscientific. Whether they claim NLP to be scientific or unscientific, they're doing injustice to it. They're not being completely true because it's too vast a subject to be covered in one research. But specific NLP techniques have been researched upon. Some of them have proved to be unscientific and have been discarded. Some of them have proved to be scientific, and therefore a lot of people continue to use it.
So, it's like NLP. So there's one question that can be NLP learned from only from books or tapes?
Conceptual understanding, yes, but NLP is a highly, highly practical process.
Yeah.
So, any NLP learning without practical exposure and experience is highly limited. But I wouldn't even say you would understand 1% of power of NLP by going through videos and books. You will understand that it's powerful, but you will not really be able to experience it. And if you're not able to experience it, you will not be able to work with it as effectively. The best way of learning NLP in our understanding is actually completely classroom training. The problem with complete classroom training is it can become extremely extensive.
Yeah.
So in our understanding, the most effective approach, given the time constraint and given the fact that it's extensive, is to go through a program which talks about or which covers the philosophy and the theory behind NLP through the online modules.
Okay.
And then obviously you can focus completely on the practice sessions and discussions and demonstrations in the classroom session. If you combine hypnosis with that, then that probably becomes the best NLP course. In fact, it becomes the best course to understand human behavior.
That's excellent. So, our next question is there any certified body of NLP which validates that a person is qualified NLP trainer?
So, there are a lot of institutes that offer NLP certification.
Yeah.
Okay. We are one of them. Right? Though we don't really offer only NLP certification, we kind of combine it with a lot of other things. But anyways, the question is there a certification body? There is no legal validity to any of these certifications.
Okay.
Certifications are issued by individual institutes saying that you have done a course with them. There are international associations which are again private bodies. So there are different training institutes that have come together to form an association, which is again a private body. Is there any legal validity to any of those associations? The answer is no. NLP, hypnosis, coaching, all of these are non-regulated fields.
In India?
Worldwide.
Okay.
There are no legal regulations in terms of any of them.
Okay.
Truly speaking, I wouldn't recommend for you to do it, but truly speaking, if tomorrow morning you were to get up and you were to just say that I'm an NLP coach, there is no legal action that can be taken against you. Okay?
Fine.
Because these are non-regulated fields. So then the question is, why should I go through an NLP program or a coaching program? Because you're not doing these programs for certifications. You're doing these programs for skills. You have to understand what is the objective of attending a program. The objective of attending a program, especially of the nature of hypnosis, NLP, coaching, psychotherapy, is the understanding it gives you about the human mind and the way you can apply that understanding into action.
Yeah.
Right? No certification is worth the knowledge and the skill that you get in this program. Okay. So yeah, to answer your question, there is no regulatory body. There are a lot of associations. They are all private associations. There are a lot of institutes that offer NLP certification. They are all private bodies.
Okay.
None of them have any legal regulations.
So in future, not anybody can just raise a question against you or any NLP practitioner.
Unless someday the government decides to regulate NLP officially, legally by passing a law in the parliament, unlikely. And will that ever happen? Highly, highly unlikely. Now what can happen? And we are really hoping this would happen. Then remember I said NLP can be applied in multiple areas,
yeah.
Right? So technically regulating NLP is almost impossible, because how would you regulate every area of application,
yeah.
Right? What you can regulate is where it is applied. So in certain countries, for example, there are regulations of whether you can work with people who have intense negative emotions and disorders.
Yeah.
So it's not whether you're an NLP practitioner or not.
Mm.
It is whether you have the educational qualification, your legal credentials to be able to work with people who have emotional disorders.
Yeah.
If you can, then NLP is just an additional skill that you have. So NLP is not becoming a legal basis to work with those people. You need other credentials to work with those people. NLP or hypnosis only becomes an additional skill set that you have. A very effective skill set to that extent. But it's still an effective skill set. It's not legally allowing or disallowing you to practice with those people.
Excellent.
Okay. So what can get regulated is this. That the application of it can be regulated. That only people who have a basic educational qualification, some amount of experience, can work with people who have intense negative emotions and disorders, and that we think sooner or later would come. But its overall application in terms of training programs, in terms of coaching, in terms of leadership, in terms of mentoring, in terms of just advertising, marketing,
mm-hmm.
rapport building, I don't think those are areas that you can regulate, because they're too vast.
Yeah, absolutely. So, well, let's hope for the best that it will regulate soon. Our next question is, if anyone has to do NLP certification, from where can one do? And there are many NLP institutes or trainers. It's confusing for people, like where can one do and which one to choose exactly.
Okay. See, to be fair, if you ask me which is the institute where you should do NLP from, we have a program of our own, and obviously I am a bit biased in favor of that. I've created that content, I've created that curriculum. So in my opinion, that's probably the best curriculum that you can go through, simply because, one, it's comprehensive.
Yeah.
We have our own experience, we have our own therapy centers, we have our own people who are working with clients and so on. So we get first-hand experience in terms of what techniques are working, what techniques are not working.
Yeah.
Right. Second, our program does not only focus on NLP. It incorporates NLP, hypnosis, mindfulness, elements of cognitive therapy into a single curriculum from coaching point of view. So our level 1 and level 2 completely focuses on that. And the moment we start moving towards level 3 and level 4, which is where you are applying NLP or any of these skills towards therapy, we have incorporated a lot of principles from humanistic psychology, we have incorporated a lot of principles from psychodynamics. So to that extent, both coaching and psychotherapy applications are very, very eclectic and very, very comprehensive. Okay?
Yeah.
So I really believe that our program is the best program out there. Also, the ongoing support that you receive, as I discussed earlier,
yeah.
is probably second to none. The fact that you have access to online modules which take care of concepts, we also give you access to all the techniques that you've practiced in the class as pre, as post-workshop recordings, so that you can always have something of a refresher, is very, very handy. Plus, it also means that whenever we update our courses,
mm-hmm.
we update the online modules to ensure that our existing participants
mm-hmm.
are always in sync with what we have done earlier. So they don't really have to pay again and again to do the same set of course only because some updates have been made.
Mm-hmm.
So again, you know, all of those are reasons why I personally believe that our course is probably the best course. Having said that, obviously we are not operating in every city in the world.
Yeah.
So there are places where you may want to do a course and you may not be able to attend the program with us. If that's the case, then I would recommend that, one, please check the curriculum online. But the fact is, online you will find most curriculum to be same.
Yeah.
In fact, for example, a lot of institutes that we have now checked out, a lot of them who earlier used to say that hypnosis and NLP have nothing to do with each other, have now started saying that we offer NLP plus hypnosis together.
Mm-hmm.
But when you actually look at the curriculum, the only thing in hypnosis they are teaching is hypnotic inductions. I'm really sorry, hypnosis is a lot more than that. Okay. That's basically a hogwash.
Yeah.
But anyways, that's, I guess, again, you know, it's everyone has to promote their services and they have to do what they have to do. So my suggestion would be, speak to the trainers.
Yeah.
Once you have a conversation with the trainers, ask them questions that help you understand how much they know about hypnosis, how much they know about NLP, whether they are able to help you understand how to club them together, whether they would provide you the post-workshop services to be able to support that or not. Check what is the mechanism through which they provide you post-workshop support. Any NLP, hypnosis or coaching or therapy program.
Mm-hmm.
Unless you're doing it for self-help. If you're doing it for self-help, that's completely alright.
Yeah.
But if you're going to work with other people, okay, you need a group of people who will provide you post-workshop support, because you will work with clients, you will work with coaches, you will work with participants where you will realize you got stuck.
Yeah.
You need someone to be able to help you with that. So if your training institute does not have the manpower or the system in place to provide you with that support, then I would suggest refrain from doing a training program with them. Also, as I said, the best judge is talk to them, speak to them. If you have been able to speak to them and if they have been able to give you the clarity that you require, then that's the institute that you do a training program with. And check the post-workshop support. I think that's probably the two things that I would
best
say is the most important. And check reviews.
Yeah.
But again, you have to be careful about reviews. A lot of reviews are self-generated and self-posted.
Yeah,
so,
like, next question is, what should we see while going for an NLP course?
The same thing that I mentioned earlier, that basically if you want to go through an NLP course, then check the institute, the website, the course curriculum, though these will not be highly reliable, but that's still the starting point. See if you can talk to the trainers, and what is your experience of talking to the trainers? Have the trainers been patient enough to be able to answer your questions, your queries? Have they been able to satisfy your questions, queries completely? I understand that a lot of institutes which offer post-workshop support will not allow you to directly connect to the trainer. You may have to connect to some person in the back end, in the admin, who would help you get the initial details about the curriculum. If you're not satisfied with the response that the admin has given you, I would suggest ask the admin to help you connect to the trainers. Your assessment should be based on your interaction with the trainers, because eventually they are the ones who are going to provide you with the post-workshop support. But for any institute to provide you with post-workshop support, they have to kind of delegate certain work, right? So most good training institutes will have admin who would, or people on calls who would be able to give you initial details about the program. But if you have any technical questions, they should be able to connect you back to the trainer, and then that's where you take your assessment from.
As you were saying about the curriculum, how will one get to know that this is the best curriculum you should go for?
As I said, one, the curriculum will be available on their website, ideally.
Yeah.
If any institute does not show their curriculum on the website, okay, I'm not really sure if I want to even proceed more than that.
Yeah.
You should at least have some details. I understand that certain institutes may ask you to download a brochure to get the complete curriculum. That's a separate issue. But at least you should have a mechanism to understand what that curriculum is. Post that, you can then prepare your questions, connect with the trainers, and then let the trainers answer whatever questions you have. So that's the best way of assessing the curriculum.
Yeah.
The course curriculum by itself, and then your interaction with the trainers in order to see whether they've been able to help you address the questions that you have.
Excellent. So our last question is, how can I learn to train others in NLP?
So a lot of NLP institutes will also have train the trainer programs. So generally the NLP training programs work this way. There's NLP practitioner, NLP master practitioner, then NLP train the trainer. In NLP train the trainer, you will have NLP train the trainer for practitioner and NLP train the trainer for master practitioner.
And that's really quite confusing.
No, so it's like you're going first through a set of programs so that you can work with people one-to-one.
Yeah.
And you can conduct training programs on self-help. And then the last two, train the trainer programs, is where you are training other people to become trainers in NLP.
Yeah.
Okay. Right? So, you will just have to speak to the individual institutes to check how they offer it. If you are an existing trainer who is only looking at incorporating techniques of NLP into your training program, and you are not really looking at doing practitioner, master practitioner program, then you don't actually even need to do an NLP train the trainer program. Many a times, if you have done the practitioner, or if required, even a master practitioner with a good institute, the training that you go through is enough for you to be able to incorporate a lot of those techniques into your program. Okay. In fact, we actually go out of our way to assist our trainer participants to understand which techniques can be incorporated where and how they can make use of it in their training program. The NLP train the trainer program is effective or required when you want to become a trainer to train other people to be an NLP practitioner. Okay. Speak to the individual institute. Every institute have their own guidelines and how they go about it. So that details the institute should be able to provide to you.
So thank you, Mr. Nitin Shah, for clearing our most of the doubts on NLP. If you have any other doubts, please mention in the comments. Anything, Priya sir?
So, yeah, so if you have any questions that we have not addressed, then please post in the comments. We would surely maybe do a follow-up webinar to answer all of those questions. Also, if you have liked this video, please comment on it, please share it, please help us spread the word. If you have any questions about NLP, you can directly connect with me, you can directly contact me. Just visit the iCHAZ website, I'll leave the link in the comments. On the iCHAZ website, once you speak to the admin will be able to connect you to me. If you want, I'll also leave a contact number of my own so that you can directly connect with me. Also, if you have specific topics that you would want us to do more webinars on, please post it on the comments so subsequently we can also do webinars on those topics.
Thank you.
So thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it, you found it useful. Hope to connect with you soon. Thank you.